What sort of animals used to exist 100,000 years ago that went extinct? Giant sloths, short-faced bears, Neanderthal? But for that matter, what sort of variants of bacteria and viruses? Due to the shifting climate through time, changes in the landscape, and in general, the extinctions of local flora and fauna, creatures, whether they be microscopic or multicellular that used to thrive, found themselves over the thousand centuries being met with increasing difficulty concerning their survival. Ultimately, a lot of animals would make it out and adapt to these changes, but some weren't so lucky. Humanity is one of the major lucky ones, not only surviving, but thriving. That thriving, however, would come at a cost. Much like bacteria in a petri dish, with the colonies continuing to grow and use up resources until it's detrimental to itself, it seems humanity would do the same, which sort of parallels our species currently. But we are attempting to actually do something about it. 2021 is going to be the year of the electric car, mark my words. Regardless, as the temperatures of Earth continue to rise due to carbon dioxide release, a receding of the ice in the Canadian Arctic would unleash a species of parasite long contained. This species would prove to be more than a match for our bodies, as likely it's been quite a long time since we were exposed to it. So today, we all saw the thumbnail. We are talking about the movie The Thaw, which if you've never seen it, I really wouldn't blame you. It's a Val Kilmer movie. But it's a little also heavy-handed on the whole climate change science, but the parasites at least make it interesting. We will also discuss Homo sapiens' natural immunity to parasites and how these creatures may have survived the deep freeze until our eventual release once more. Or really, we will discuss how unlikely it is that they survive that deep freeze. But speaking of tundras and cold, that done, let's get to why the guy who caused an energetic release of concussive force at a pipeline because he was upset about it may not be the most stable dude on the planet to make a judgment call on the release of a plague of parasites that humanity has no immunity nor effective way to combat. We open up our story with David Crouppen talking about the woes of humanity. Questioning why nobody is willing to sacrifice for the planet, he laments over his career, as even though he's been heard by scholars and common people alike, nothing seems to be working. He mentions how he rediscovered what he knew when he was young. Basically, he became soft in his old age. We cut to a woman with something sticking out of her forehead as it slithers back into her scalp. Ouchies! So yeah, that's gonna be a new straight up personal fear of mine. Before all this happened though, David and his team found a polar bear way south of where it should be. Despite it being early spring, there should be more snow and ice where they are, and presumably the bear came south for food. And it did in fact find some food. They tagged the polar bear with a trank shot and then knock it out. The bear was eating something in the ice with a crow joining in, and as they descend to check out the bear, their native guide begins yelling. They look down into the ice and spot the bear was actually eating a woolly mammoth frozen in the ice. Talk about some freezer burned meat right there. Half a planet away, a group of college students are selected to go to David's compound, and that makes it sound really nefarious, and it is nefarious. Anyways, they'll be meeting with David to help him with his work that he's doing to combat climate change. Initially, there were supposed to be four students, but stuck in a traffic jam is David's daughter. David calls her, and apparently, she's not too thrilled to hear from him. He had missed the mom's funeral, so obviously the daughter was a little upset. David promises that he will give her all the mother's money if she just comes up, and she obliges, but this is what knocks out one of the students from going to Captain David's house of fun. Back at the compound, the guide comes out to inform everyone that the polar bear has succumbed to whatever mystery disease it contracted. 2 days later, we meet Bart the helicopter pilot. David calls and warns him not to bring his daughter up, and Bart obliges. Back at the forward operating base, or FOB, David is sitting staring at the mammoth, and Jane comes in to check on him and ask him if he had called for help yet, but David is looking a little unfocused. They all appear to be a bit sick and struggling. The guy that they had already been infected and began to be worse off than most. David lies about calling help, and Jane leaves. Back at the helicopter, Evelyn is told that she is not allowed to come up with Bart, but she completely ignores him and then gets on anyways. They take off over the Canadian tundra towards the base to meet up with David and the rest of the group. While en route, Sue's been questioning the daughter about her dad, and it's pretty clear at this point that she would rather not be here, and this upsets the students as she's the reason that one of them are missing. At the FOB, Jane is lying in the tent when they put the dog down. The guide has already succumbed to the parasites, but David mentions how they need to protect themselves until they are ready. Jane throws up, gross, and then Edward goes to check on Jane. She questions him about being ready for what, and he doesn't answer. This begins to sow some seeds of doubt as to what is actually happening. Getting to the base, they find it's completely abandoned. No power, no running water, nobody. As they open the doors, they immediately begin to be hit with a smell, but decide that it's better just to get the generator running and they'll figure out what that is later. Bart goes to check on it, and meanwhile, Federico and Ling were obviously doing the horizontal tango at some point in their career. rear with one another and then they make up. Which would prove to be an awful idea later, but you know, what can you do? As Evelyn looks for some paperwork that she needs to get all her mother's money, we get some backstory on our boy Adam. And no, not like Adam like A-D-A-M, but literally Adam like A-T-O-M. Why you would name your kid this is beyond strange, though I guess there are kids named like Golden Apple nowadays, so maybe not the most bizarre thing. Anyways, he talks about how his dad was an oil rig owner and they hit sour gas and it took out 9 people downwind, to which the dad remarked plenty more where they came from. So it upset Adam and he turned more eco-aggressive as a result. I would say the other word, but then this video would have no chance of earning anything. Cue in the people in the comments calling me selfish because I try to get things monetized. Bart comes back in search of a flashlight as Adam and Evelyn move through the lab to look for one. The smell is atrocious at this point and they flip on the lights to find that the polar bear is deceased from earlier. It's looking a little worse than normal with visible wounds all over its body. Bart decides to get a picture with it and for some reason, he rolls up his sleeves. Bad idea, Broham. As he does, he is bit by something in the forearm, but they assume it to just be a flea. Why? Why, my guy, would you roll up your sleeves to touch a dead animal? The absolute mad lad. Back at the FOB, the guide and dog are buried, having been exposed to the parasite apparently earlier than anybody else. Jane is able to get in contact after the radio in the bag goes off with Evelyn looking for everyone. Jane calls out that the students are here and that Evelyn also came with. David is mildly upset by this news, more so than normal, but he asks her to just stay there and for the love of God, don't come up to the FOB. David and Edward talk about doing the right thing as David approaches the camp and Jane decides that enough is enough. She hits David in the shoulder with a shot as Edward runs at her with a knife. She snipes him in the heart, leading to his end as well. Back at the base, nobody shows up and everyone just kind of goes to bed for the night. As they do, Federico and Ling make up, as you know you do with ex-girlfriends, but as they are doing so, a parasite crawls across the floor. Federico freaks out as he has a phobia and then leaves the room as Ling decides to stay in there and go back to sleep. Eventually around 3 a.m., Jane shows up on the ATV. Evelyn then heads outside to check on her and finds her in the helicopter struggling to breathe. Bart wakes up and his wound on his arm is way worse and itching like crazy, to the point that he is actually bleeding now. In the base, Ling wakes up in all the commotion, covered in bites from head to toe, and instantly thinks that Federico gave her something. A pretty solid conclusion. But then Federico thinks that maybe she already had something, which is also a solid conclusion. Evelyn then calls out to the FOB, where it shows that actually David is still alive, considering he was just winged by the hit, but it ended up knocking him out. They pull Jane inside, and Federico rightly deduces this place is infested and they need to get out of there. They head out to the helicopter to look for David and Edward, but then find that the helicopter was sabotaged by Jane. They have no idea why she would do this, but as they discuss, Ling comes back out and says Jane isn't doing so well. They run back inside and then find that she is asphyxiating on her own vomit. Okay, so I break away for a moment because everybody needs more information in their life, and you know, I used to do like EMT stuff and medical stuff and blah, 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 who cares? Anyways, when somebody is asphyxiating on vomit, immediately roll them over on their side. Don't keep them on their backs because this is literally the worst thing you can do to clear an airway. But regardless, petting people's faces and yelling at them to stay with you actually doesn't do anything, and then she suffocates. So if you would like to avoid that fate, do that for other people. So anyways, now it may not have helped because the parasites could have been, you know, in her lungs and in her stomach, but in normal circumstances with normal people under normal conditions, you now know what to do. So going back to the movie, the group realizes at this point that they need to quarantine Jane for their own safety because they have no idea what she is infected with. Jane and Adam load up on the ATV to go find her dad using the GPS coordinates on it. Eventually, they do make it to the FOB, but back at the regular base, Bart is discovering his wound keeps getting worse and worse, and this is no normal flea bite. As Evelyn and Adam search the base, they find the mammoth first. As they begin looking at it more closely, they find what appear to be eggs in the meat of this creature. And not only just that, but they are moving as the creature begins to thaw. As they exit the tent and then find that Edward's body was just outside of it, they run up the hill to find a grave that was dug for the guide and the dog. Evelyn assumes it to be her father and Adam grabs her saying that she shouldn't see him like this. She begins wailing that it's not fair because she still hates him. Okay, weird flex, but don't worry, you'll hate him worse later. They go back to the ATV and then head back to the original base. Federico, my boy, you gotta get that checked out. As he takes a pee, comes out as pretty much all blood. He accuses Ling of hooking up with somebody the last few months after seeing how sick she was. Then he realized that this is an incredibly fast-acting disease and nobody had any time to do anything else considering, you know, he's already showing symptoms himself. He mentions, however, whatever it is, it's inside him down there. And now I have a new phobia part 2, Electric Boogaloo. Adam and Evelyn come back to the base and report to Bart that everyone at the FOB has been taken out. Federico is calling for help on the radio as Evelyn moves through the base. Ling is looking even worse for wear. Evelyn is looking for evidence of eggs on Jane and then breaks her quarantine. As she lifts her stomach to midriff, she spots numerous eggs underneath the skin. She then looks in her eye and just in time and then sees a parasite swim across it. Ooh, sweet God. They decide that they need to basically isolate her more, so they take her to the lab where the polar bear is and then drop her. As Evelyn inspects the polar bear, she also finds that eggs are all over its carcass as well. The realization dawns on Evelyn that they can't leave. Most of them are infected with something and they need to call the CDC. Probably the right move, but Federico is freaking out, yelling, "Game over, man, game over." He's really just ready to GTFO as fears overtake him. He calls everyone sick at the thought of eggs being laid in people, which to a certain degree, he's right. Evelyn then takes off running to the radio to tell the chopper not to come, but then Federico actually ends up just completely destroying the radio. Ling comes walking down the hallway looking borderline done, clearly having an immune response, but they need to quarantine her immediately as clearly she's probably a goner. Back at the lab space, they watch the sheets move where Jane is as bugs begin crawling across the floor. The hatching has begun. Bart shows Evelyn his arm and says that they need to do something before that becomes him. He tries to grab the parasite by removing some skin, but as he does, it recedes further into his arm. After this, he realizes that he has to take off his arm or just completely burn it. He then grabs a meat cleaver and asks someone to do it or he will. This part is actually about just as brutal from the movie Splinter. They inject morphine into him and then tie off the arm. As they're about to do it, Federico then checks down there and he's bleeding. Sorry, bro, major bummer, that kind of sucks, but weirdly, he gets kind of sentimental for Bart's arm, that at least that's what it looks like, because that's probably what he's gonna have to do to himself. And then he comes in to stop it by firing a shot. This scares Adam, and then he is able to meat cleave the arm anyways. As Bart sits there freaking out with a meat cleaver in his arm, Adam freezes up and Evelyn has to finish the job taking off his arm. I'll tell you, man, it's blurred for you, but that looks pretty painful. So now that the arm is on the floor, Adam attempts to use bug spray on it, but it has no effect. And eventually he turns to the great equalizer, fire, and that takes care of the problem. So I just want to point out, Federico isn't like a bad dude. He's just scared. He helps Evelyn then carry Bart to the couch as they attempt to stop the bleeding as she opens up the ATV kit for injuries. She finds her dad's journal that has all the information on these things. First, they aren't bugs. They are actually vertebrates because they have a spine. Second, the males just bite you and create a wound that the female can then crawl in and lay eggs and multiply. So being bit by a male doesn't necessarily mean you're infected. They figure out that they need more information before the helicopter that Federico called in gets there. Evelyn then heads back in to search Jane. As she walks through though, the polar bear looks like it's ready to pop because it's filled to the brim with those parasites. She removes the sheet covering Jane and finds that she has been mostly eaten at this point, but she gets what she needs. As she heads to leave, Federico again freaks out and tries to seal her in. She gets out, but has to basically strip to show that she's not infected. She did, however, have a female on her trying to get into a wound to lay eggs, but Adam was able to grab it and pull it out of her before it could get in. They finally move into the media area and one of the bugs actually escaped, and they figure out that they're moving through the vents as the lab is completely infested with these parasites. When they quarantined Ling, she got trapped in a room with the females and all the bites on her. Bart then mentions that his bandage is too tight and they check and find that there are actually still eggs laid further up in his arm. So basically cutting off his arm did nothing. Federico takes a shot at Ling through the door and then says that that's what she wanted, but he kind of missed. He just hit her in the cheek. Bart then punches him, knocking the tool away from him. Then Bart goes in with Ling and decides that sedation is better than succumbing consciously. He goes in, knocks her out and himself, as they are overtaken by the parasites. The chopper arrives and Federico goes out, mentioning how they can all still escape. The issue is, however, Evelyn says they need to figure out what to do because they are infected. At this point, David shows back up and takes out Federico with his own shot and then saves Adam and Evelyn. He looks like the good guy, doesn't he? Well, actually, he's a total douche. Evelyn and Adam go back in to burn the building down with gasoline and watch the rest of the tape where it shows David infecting himself intentionally so he could bring it back to major populations. His thinking was that if they release this parasite on the planet, people would be forced to reconsider their emissions to keep these creatures like this contained. Now, why he's a freaking idiot is because he has no clue how many people, just the amount of untold masses would fall, or even if this could be like an extinction level event, considering humans are, you know, social animals and would probably socialize even if they had parasites. So regardless of the save he just pulled, David still sucks. Evelyn tries to reason him with all the points that I just mentioned, and he says that it wouldn't matter because no one would listen. listen, he's forced to more drastic measures. Again, total idiot because, you know, everything, but that's just my take on the matter. Anyways, what's even worse is the entire base is infested and he locks his daughter and Adam in there as the helicopter arrives. They're able to break a window as Adam runs to the helicopter and then jumps on. The pilot, thinking he's infected, doesn't stop and instead goes up higher when then Adam falls to his demise. Evelyn takes a shot through the window and it hits the pilot in the neck, sending the thing careening into the base, igniting the entire building, which then destroys the localized outbreak. Evelyn checks on Adam and he says that he wanted to be there to get the ball rolling, which he did, and then he meets his end. Now, near some unknown Canadian city, days later, a dog is found eating a crow. In fact, the same crow that ate the mammoth with the polar bear. This crow succumbed to the parasite and man's best friend just happened to come across it. After being called back by its owner, the person heads back into the city to unleash the parasite unknowingly. The irony of this being that humanity never even really mattered in this equation. Nature would unleash this parasite on us in the end. This brings us back to the beginning of the movie where the news reports are saying that there are tens of thousands of people infected and hundreds have already met their end by some unknown creature. Big oof, humanity. So, first things first, let's discuss a moment, basically the feasibility of this. Now, it's known right now, we may be warming things up a little bit. We know the Earth is getting hotter and it's something we need to address before it gets out of control. We're moving in the right direction with a lot of new technologies that could help us address these problems, but time will tell if this is really quick enough. Regardless, we know right now with the melting ice, we are starting to see some very strange and very old things emerge. One of these examples in particular that comes to mind is a recently pulled megavirus that's 30,000 years old and it's still infectious and still viable from the permafrost in Siberia. Now, it sounds horrifying as, you know, this suggests that viruses were A, more diverse than we originally thought for this time period, and B, a giant virus sounds pretty freaky. But the fact is, viruses just don't immediately infect people by being viruses. It's all based on cellular markers and if it can get into our cells. From what has been found, it is not capable of infecting humans, but the issue is viruses are adaptable. They can mutate and change, which is sort of like how simian immunodeficiency virus became human immunodeficiency virus, so SIV to HIV. So realistically, yes, there can be things lurking in the ice that have long thought to have been extinct that could reemerge as the ice continues to thaw. Now the issue is, what about actual cellular organisms? Cells need glucose to function. A lot of animals go through hibernation during cold winters. Their metabolism drops dramatically and with it, so does their oxygen consumption. They essentially sleep during this time, which causes them to use tremendously less energy than normal, but this is only for a few months a year. Some species of frogs, on the other hand, have completely different abilities at their disposal. Ice crystals will form within their bodies as they are frozen, but high concentrations of glucose within their vital organs allow them to basically remain somewhat functional and not destroyed by ice. The heart will stop beating and the breathing will completely cease for a frog, but as it thaws, these organs are protected and then will start back up when it reaches a certain temperature. But there's still a limit on what it is capable of. While frogs are frozen, they are still living. And because they are still living, they must use some energy within them to keep their cells alive. It's just at a massively decreased rate. Their bodies will also switch over to an anaerobic metabolism, which is less efficient at generating energy, but still quite viable considering how little they need. All this said, the meter is still ticking this whole time. Should they run out of glucose during their freeze, they would not wake back up and they will actually expire. It is hypothesized that they can last at about 7 months this way overall. There are very few other animals that even come close to what frogs can pull off, and the reasoning is you need glucose in your body to stay alive. Without it, cells will quickly expire and then you will meet your end. After all, we are really just walking chemical reactions. Take away the reaction and boom, you take away the life. So the first hurdle this parasite has in the thaw is, without the glucose needed to survive the freezing for what was theorized to be roughly 20,000 years, they would absolutely expire. Their bodies were small and even if frozen completely through, the cells would still need glucose in order to survive. And they would not just have the stores necessary to survive that long of a freeze. So likely, in our universe, there is really not going to be any crazy animals coming back to life to wreak havoc on human society. Now, ancient bacteria and viruses, that's another story though. But this is why humanity still hasn't completely figured out how to cryo-freeze something and then bring it back to life. Without massively high concentrations of glucose in the cells freeze and then burst due to water contained within. As the parasite cells use glucose in their bodies, even if they could survive freezing for periods of time, considering it was the ice age, as glucose decreased, the balance would shift in their cells and they would burst due to the formation of jagged ice crystals in their cells. So apart from that glaring biological issue, what sort of animals are the parasites? Well, interestingly, as mentioned previously, they aren't bugs. Instead, they are vertebrates vertebrates, much like you and me. And while there are not very many parasites that are vertebrates, at its fundamental core, it's really just a small animal that burrows into the skin and fatty tissue of a bigger animal, hatches, eats the host as it grows until the host expires, and then moves outward to find more hosts in which to lay eggs in. That said, naturally, we do have some immunity to parasites, or at least ways to attack them, for anyone that really possesses a functional immune system. When the body first learns of a foreign invader within itself, it usually has a panic hormone put out by cells in a certain area that alert the macrophages or white blood cells that I'm straight up not having a good time. The macrophages will then move in to investigate, and upon coming into contact with something as massive as a parasite, they will begin attacking immediately. This is effective in some ways, as it's known as the innate immune system. This is the first line of defense against parasites, bacteria, viruses, and can be effective in most cases. However, the heavy hitters against parasites lie a few days away and within the adaptive immune system. The adaptive immune system is like kind of going from a police force being the innate immune system to special forces being the adaptive immune system. When things aren't looking so hot and the innate immune system is being overwhelmed, information on the invader is brought back to the lymphatic system and newer cells are created to deal with it. T cells, B cells, cytokine storms, basically, this is your body's ace in the hole. Concise and targeted attacks against whatever is wreaking havoc on the old meat suit. In the thaw, we can see initially the innate becomes activated in various ways after infection. When Bart becomes infected at its very surface level, more so in the fatty tissue, which will be important we will discuss later, the eggs are laid there just under the surface of the skin and then become itchy, which is another symptom of the innate activation. Itching, inflammation, and skin destruction. However, if you notice, Bart still seems okay a few days after being infected. Jane, after being infected, continues to throw up much like Ling does, and this is no surprise. In Jane and Ling specifically, you can tell that the adaptive immune system is being activated in them. As the body becomes more and more aware of something foreign in its midst, fever would begin to spike, leading to sweating and chills in an effort to sort of change the optimal reproduction temperatures to help the body get a foothold on ousting whatever it is. As the body goes into full attack mode, vomiting would be a major symptom of intestinal distress, and this becomes more common, but the girls were also infected in a different way than Bart was, or even Federico. Ling was covered in bites in areas on her body that do not house a lot of fat, and the same goes with Jane. As the parasites moved in, they hit areas that were highly patrolled by the immune system. After coming into contact with the parasite, the adaptive would be quickly alerted, which led to their symptoms much faster. As the parasites also moved deeper into the body cavities, they would really find the lungs and stomach too, which may also be why we see them in rougher shape. Specifically, Bart had his bite location more localized. There was no body cavities to move into, and instead, the fatty tissue served as the parasite's home. The thing about parasites is that often they do move into areas of the body considered to be immune privileged. These areas, such as the eyes or fatty tissue, are not patrolled by immune cells as regularly. Because of this, Bart's infection took longer to produce the same symptoms that we saw in the girls. However, after removing the skin, the creature then receded deeper into his arm, which allowed it to lay eggs further up his bicep, which pretty much sealed his fate. So with this powerful immune system response at play, you'd probably expect the body to clear the disease. Well, there are multiple issues that make it virtually impossible. First, it's not completely uncommon for humans not to clear a parasitic infection, even with parasites we come across, because they co-adapted to us. Tapeworms, ringworms, scabies, malaria, really there are just a lot of parasites that despite an all-out attack from our immune system, we just can't seem to destroy them. We are effective in some ways, but how might this parasite be bypassing our immunities? Well, it's clear to me, we just don't have the firepower to take these things out. The first issue is they are larger than the usual suspects that we have to deal with. Granted, a tapeworm could get really, really long. It's not really so much in your meat as it is in your intestines. When a group of cells basically clump up on a parasite and try to destroy it, if it's smaller, this is more effectively done. And actually, some parasites have been known to basically shed an outer shell to get the cells off them, just so you know. But with larger parasites comes with thicker skin. This thickness allows them to resist a lot of attacks that our bodies can put down range. Not to mention, as the creature is larger, it is able to move faster. If a particular amount of cells were to, say, try to group up, the creature could then move out of the area faster, and really, they couldn't move as fast as it to catch up. Another issue is, likely the great equalizer, mucus comes into play. This is basically how we are finding biofilms right now that are resistant to all of our antibiotics, despite the bacteria alone being susceptible to our countermeasures. When you have a mucus secretion, the cells, cytokines, and antibodies, or really any anti-parasite measure in general, have a tougher time getting to the actual parasite to melt it down. Because of this, the body's defenses get stuck, and they can't make proper contact to it to destroy it, and this makes them virtually immune to our body's defenses. This parasite likely has this because it does not appear to be specific to any one creature's immune systems. Mammoths, crows, dogs, humans, it appears to be able to latch onto any species of animal, burrow into the fatty tissue, and if it's in the stomach, really burrow into the stomach or body cavities, and then lay its eggs. Oh, and the same issue applies to the eggs this creature lays, likely coated in this mucus from the parent as well as a membrane. The cells aren't able to break them down. These eggs would need to be quite tough, as even they survived the freezing of the mammoth and were still able to produce viable young. Ultimately, what does this mean for humanity along with every other animal on the planet? And this is my biggest issue with this movie. You're talking about a parasite that seems to violate the laws of biology and was so massively successful. Apart from squishing it or taking out with fire, there doesn't appear to be any natural immunities in any animal that it came across. Despite different immune systems and likely stronger immune systems of other animals, this parasite is able to overcome all of them. So the problem is, nobody would be around right now if this was the case. Why would this one mammoth house the only parasites? Surely other animals survived, otherwise Earth would be just completely barren right now. And those parasites would have eaten all those animals until there was nothing left but them. They try to mention how this was an island, but nah, I don't buy that. Everything was frozen over, and more animals would have come into contact with this parasite, like birds, which can fly, obviously, or fish, which could swim, and even other mammoths, considering mammoths were social creatures just like elephants are. So, with this super parasite that can just infect everything on the planet, the best way I would say would be to compare it to sort of like a bubonic plague. Fleas on rats transferred Yersinia pestis to humans, which in turn infected them and took them out. In this case, however, all animals, including humans, can transfer this parasite to everything, and it would be taken out. So basically, humanity is screwed as long as there's other animals on the planet, and there's really no way to rely on the climate to take these things out, as they can just bypass every biological function to survive tens of thousands of years, completely violating the laws of nature to do so. So really, your only chance to take these things out is going to be fire, which is not really that effective. You could create like a wall of fire and a bird could still come fly in and drop a bunch of parasites on you. So basically, humanity is going to have to up that anti-parasite medicine game. And I wrap this up by saying what we may find under the ice as things continue to thaw will likely be pretty freaky in some cases. The fact is, things thought to be extinct or we didn't even know about may still be down there in the melting permafrost and could by all accounts be released. In fact, recently they revived a 30,000-year-old flower that we have never seen before because of this. But the chances of a parasite being frozen for that long without using any glucose would have been about the same survivability rate that we see with a frozen mammoth. They aren't coming back unless for some reason we wanted to bring them back, which just seems like a bad case of genetic engineer gone horribly insane. But hey, who knows? Maybe some people just want to watch the world thaw. Yeah!